introduction of what we are doing in the hospital. We have planned actually, then there will be no confusion for everybody. So what we do is, I think there's a government circular, not only our hospital, every hospital has to be triage now, open a triage center. So in our hospital, director has identified a room, separate room to examine these patients, and now we have arranged, yesterday we have finalized it. At the OPD level, our plan is, so other hospitals also, they can make any adjustments and can have their own plans. I will tell what we are going to do in the Vavuniya. At the OPD level, we are going to keep a nurse at the entrance, and we will ask, we want to separate patients who are not suspected of corona and patients who have any suspicious case for the corona. For that, I have included in the triage, in this guideline, I will give you a copy. Our hospital, of course, definitely will get a copy for each unit, but other hospitals, so I ask them to give one copy each. Amendments you can do and have a copy for your, have a own guideline for your hospital. Here I mentioned in the OPD at the triage, so there's one nurse in the entrance, and that nurse will ask some questions from the patients, and we divided into two, one who is suspected and one who is not. So there are two, the door is middle. This side, the patients who have not suspected of this corona virus issue, so we'll send those patients to that side. Other patients we are sending to the other side, which we have a identified separate room. We are going to allocate one doctor for that room for a 24 hours cover hereafter, and that doctor is quickly examine the patient, and initially this is a brief separation, brief description, so that other doctor is having a good discussion and do a quick examination of the respiratory system and discuss with the casualty VP, VP, OPD or pediatrician, casualty pediatrician. So then they discuss with them and they take a decision whether this, discussion of the consultant can take a decision whether this patient fits the case definition, need to transfer or not. In our hospital, as you all know, we have opened this infectious disease unit today, but only thing, we have a big quarantine center here. So we can't have corona suspected and non-corona suspected both at the same place. So because of that, we have decided until the quarantine process is over, we are admitting patients from the quarantine centers with illnesses other than suspected corona, because we can't mix up the patient. It's not a separate single room isolation, it's a cohort type of isolation unit we have started today. So the other patient who have suspected corona patients, we have advised them to directly transfer from the quarantine center to the either Anuradhapura or Jaffa. But any patient who has come from the community to our OPD, then that is our issue, OPD, so in that separate room, the doctor who is there quickly examine, discuss with the directly with the consultant, because we don't want to unnecessary delay of any decisions, because while we are keeping the patient is unnecessary exposure to anybody. So rather than no point of discussing the SHO, HO like that, you have to go to the higher level, to the maximum higher level, take the decision. So directly OPD attending doctor discuss with the consultant, either casualty VP, VP OPD or the pediatrician, casualty pediatrician, and take a decision. Is it fits the case definition? Then and there arrange the ambulance and transfer to either Jaffa Natu or Anuradhapura. At the moment, that is what we are doing in our hospital, because we have a quarantine center. For the quarantine center, what we asked is, I think director has asked, if there's any suspicious case, non-corona case with any other ailment like chest pain, abdominal pain, whatever the other tissues, they will contact directly our director, and director will give the casualty consultant's phone number, then they can discuss directly with the casualty consultant. After that, they can bring the patient to, with his consent, if it is necessary, can bring the patient to the our isolation unit. So hereafter, the casualty unit will follow up that patient. That is what we have planned at the moment in our hospital. So in the triage area, what I told is, I have given in all three languages, English and Sinhala and Tamil. Here first we have to ask about the symptoms of acute respiratory tract infection, and then we have to find out whether there's an epidemiological link. What do you mean by it? Whether there's any contact with these cases. So how to identify is, because I don't want to go into detail, otherwise it will be a long discussion. So I have mentioned how to identify whether this patient has an epidemiological link, travel or contact with these things, and what are the high-risk countries which have at the moment decided by the WHO. Other thing I have to tell, this, because of this evolving thing, daily things are updated. So this is actually, we made this guideline, what was the available information up to yesterday. But it can be may change from today or tomorrow. For any news, I think all of you all have smartphone. You are using smartphone to go for other Facebook, internet, anything. All the latest guidelines, whatever the updates, it's available in epidemiology unit website. This is up to yesterday. So it can be changed from tomorrow onward. So you daily, if there's anything, they will issue it as a new guideline, I think. So in that case, you can daily, you can review the guideline. Just go through and see whether there's a new guideline. Because old guidelines we have included and just go through. So there are things, they are updated. Maybe they will add some other countries in the future like that. There are, I think, more than 14, 15, I think, high transmission countries I have included, but can be added. So always refer the epidemiology guideline, our epidemiology guideline. So in that case, you can, from the triage center, you can identify if this patient is a suspected case of corona or not. In that patient, sent to that separate room, they will be seen in that room. And after that, as I told, they will take the decision. Then we have another problem, whom to wear PP and not to wear PP like that. In this guideline, corona suspected patients we are transferring. But if we get a patient to the quarantine also, we have to treat this patient as a suspicious case because they are from the quarantine period, they are coming anytime, they can become positive. So I clearly mentioned whom to wear PP and what are the things you have to wear like that in the how to manage in the isolation unit, that is for our doctors. Then I have given a full guideline about how to identify this as a suspected case, how to identify a contact, all those things I have mentioned in the guideline. This is everything in a summary, like it's a nutshell, everything in a nutshell, I make it a summary so you can read easily. It's in English, no translation, only the first page I have translated into what we are going to ask, everything I have mentioned, confirmed case, probable case, criteria for testing, those things also I add, what are the samples to collect, if any case, if you want to send the samples and how to send the samples like that. In here, of course, we are not managing suspected corona, but in the meantime, if we have to manage corona cases, what we ask them is to take the sample and hand over the sample to the infection control unit, because there's a way to send with a triple package system is introduced to send, that is the way you have to send category A hazard pathogens, biohazard high risk pathogens. So that part our infection control unit will do. They will put it in, they will demonstrate for the everybody to know. Don't know at what time, if we hopefully it will not, we hope for the best not to happen, but if there are so many cases, maybe own ward has to send because the workload is high. Definitely for the other hospitals, they will demonstrate how to have this triple package system. For that, arrange ambulance and we have to send, you can't just send like other samples, they have to send in triple package. So then about infection control precautions. I have clearly mentioned as the standard precautions, droplet precautions, but up to now the main mode of droplets. But what they say is the new finding is if you produce a aerosol generating procedure that initially also we have suspected, that now confirmed, there's a risk of airborne spread from the aerosol generating procedure. They said after doing a procedure, there's a risk of staying the virus with this airborne particle for some times in that environment. Because of that, still there's no change in the recommendation. You have to wear N95 for the aerosol generating procedures. Others not. Aerosol generating procedures I have mentioned, like bronchoscopy, induced sputum production. That means sometimes if the patient doesn't get good sputum, we induce by nebulizing a normal saline to get deep sputum. And positive pressure ventilation with a mask, intubation, extubation, and airway suction. Those are the conditions. There's a risk of aerosol generating procedures. Okay. So in that case, only they have recommended N95 mask. Initially they have suspected and recommended. Now they have confirmed from that route you can get it. That is also everything about standard precautions, deprived precautions, and these aerosol generating procedures, everything I have mentioned here. Then the next one, there's a big guideline in the Ministry of Health, which have published by the Ministry of Health, but it's very difficult for you all to read, I know. Important situation, what are the PP you have to use? Because otherwise everyone is panicking to have full PP. It's not real necessary, because these are best practice. They have obtained these from best practice guidelines. That means they are evidence-based, so you don't want to worry. By trials, they have identified. So this is actually our Ministry of Health, but they have got it from WHO guidelines. I have gone through, so don't worry. Simply, I mentioned in a patient room, healthcare worker, cleaner, and visitor, what are the level of PPE needed, and in other areas like wards and corridors, how to what are the PPEs necessary? Actually, they say no PPE required. I saw people are going with the mask. Even mask is not necessary if you walk in the wards and corridors. So if I tell you briefly, because this is the most panicking situation, in a patient rooms, healthcare workers providing direct care to COVID-19 patients, you have to use medical mask, gowns, gloves and eye protection, either goggles or face shield. First contact people suspected here, no need N95 medical mask in, because there's no aerosol generated procedures you are doing there. And if there's aerosol generated procedures performed on COVID-19 patients, they asked to wear a N95 mask or FFP, if it's not available it's in other countries, this FFP respirators, gowns, gloves, eye protection, and in addition to those things, ask a plastic apron, a polythene apron to wear. And cleaners also enter in the room for COVID-19 patients. Medical mask, gowns, heavy duty gloves usually, because otherwise they can get needle prick and those things, eye protection, and either boots or closed working shoes for those people. Visitors entering the room with COVID-19 patients, medical mask, gown and gloves. That's what they recommended. You don't want to go beyond that. Other areas, that means walking in corridors and other areas of the patient transit. I have to tell, wards and corridors. All staff, including healthcare workers, any activity that does not involve contact with COVID-19 patients, no PPE required. To walk in the wards and to walk in the corridors, if you are not doing any activity with direct contact with the patient, no need PPE. Even a mask is not there. You just can walk. So in the triage area, likewise, here they have mentioned in the triage area. Simply, I tell triage area healthcare workers, that means including doctors, preliminary screening not involved in direct contact. If you are doing a preliminary screening not involving a direct contact, what they say is maintain spatial distance of at least 1 meter. Because what they say is this droplet, the main mode of droplet is droplet, maximum go up to 1 meter. It doesn't go beyond 1 meter, that means 3 feet. So if you maintain 1 meter distance, you are protective. Then no PPE required. Other thing I have to tell you, we are always asking you to wash the hands. You are thinking, why? Because this illness, main mode of transmission is not the droplet. It main mode is the indirect contact. That is what will happen is, when a patient coughs, it will spread and settle down in the environment within a 1 meter around. So after that, patient would have gone. But you don't know whether there's a patient in or not. You will just come, because we know these viruses stay sometimes in the air. We don't know exactly how long. There are so many ideas, but what they say is roughly at least 48 hours it can be stay in the environment. So what will happen is, you just come, you touch the patient cough here, you touch the table without hand washing, you touch your mouth, nose and eyes, then it goes through the mouth, mucous membranes and the conjunctiva, not through intact skin. It doesn't go through intact skin. So when you touch the mouth, nose, mucous membrane and this conjunctiva, it will go in. That is the main mode of spread, because it's very unlikely at nowadays a person to come and cough in front of you. Because now all are careful about, if a patient has respirator, you just always keep the distance, and they also be careful. We always ask them to have cough etiquette, that means keep something to cough, like a tissue or a handkerchief or like that. So that is why main mode of spread is indirect spread, which we are not concentrating at all. We always fighting and shouting for the mask, but nobody want to wash hands. Other thing, don't worry about hand gels, because what they say is, for any infectious diseases, hand washing is first. That prevent more, because always alcohol is an alternative. This alcohol ramp is where there are some diseases which can't kill by alcohol hand, but luckily this is an envelope virus, so easily disintegrate. You can easily destroy. So because of that, washing hand is the best method. Always you try to wash your hands. Don't think using alcohol ramp hand is superior to washing hands. Because yesterday there was a big issue, so I asked to prepare in-house preparation, because now everybody is panicking. If we try to restrict things, there will be bad repercussions. That's why actually, if you can wash hands, that's what I told it. If you go and see one patient to the other, then it's difficult. If you are doing order, seeing this patient, going to the washing hands, that is difficult. In that case, using hand rub is practical. But if you are seeing intermittent, like one patient is coming, you are clerking the patient, then you get a patient in another 10-15, so you easily you can go and wash your hands before the next patient. That's the best thing to do, unless you are gone looking at a patient, then difficult. They tell, if you can maintain a 1 meter of a spatial distance, you don't want to have any kind of PPE, unless you are directly within 1 meter, and unless you have a contact within 1 meter of the patient, only you have to wear PPE. And the patients with respiratory symptoms, any patient with the respiratory symptoms, this is at the triage, any patient with the respiratory symptom maintain spatial distance of at least 1 meter or providing what they say is providing medical mask if the patient is tolerating. If you want to go closer, if you don't want to actually, if you are not wearing PP, either you give a medical mask if you are going closer to the patient, otherwise maintain 1 meter. If not, you have to wear a medical mask. A patient without respiratory symptom, no precaution at all. No precautions means standard precaution. Each and everybody has to practice to prevent hospital acquired infection. Other than that, no special precaution for this. No special PP. Other thing for laboratory workers. Consultation room, same. Direct contact, aerosols 95. Other patients, only medical mask. Yes, other thing is ambulance driver, other problematic area. So the ambulance or vehicle transfer, transfer of vehicle. Healthcare workers transporting suspected COVID-19 patients to the referral healthcare facility. Healthcare workers, if you accompany the patient, a healthcare worker accompany the patient, medical mask, gowns, gloves and eye protection. Okay, but the driver. Now we have this compartmentalized ambulance. That means patient's area separated complete from the driver and the helper. So those type of ones involve only in the driving. Patient with suspected COVID-19 disease and the driver's compartment is separated from the COVID-19 patient. If so, maintain spatial distance of at least 1 meter if you are handling the patient and no PP is required. Because it's separated from the patient. Assisting with, or else the driver is assisting with loading or unloading the patient with suspected COVID-19 disease, then only you have to have medical mask, gloves and eye. So if you are sending with the driver have to unload the patient, definitely then you can provide. Otherwise, not necessary. If you driver doesn't want to handle, always maintain 1 meter distance. And no direct contact with the with patient with suspected COVID-19, but no separation between the driver and the medical patient compartment. If there's no direct contact, but there's no separation, in that case, they ask only the medical mask. These are from WHO guidelines, which they have extracted, the Ministry of Health, which is extracted. So that is what we have to add. Other thing, patient with suspected COVID-19 disease, if you want to transport to a referral healthcare facility, that is, of course, we have to know medical mask. If the patient is tolerated, can tolerate a medical mask, you can give if you transport the patient to a healthcare facility or some other department in the hospital if it's really necessary. Always you have to minimize. Cleaners, of course, how to do cleaning part. Cleaners, of course, they have to wear ambulance cleaners, medical mask, gowns, gloves, eye protection, and cleaning after and between transport of the patient with suspected COVID-19 disease to referral healthcare facility. Those people, they have to wear medical mask, gowns, gloves, eye protection. Eye protection, what they say is if risk of splash from organic material or chemicals, and boots or clothes, work shoes like for other cleaning stuff. So that's of who you have to know. Other, I have given a guideline. This is also WHO guideline, which extracted from WHO guideline published in our website, epidemiology website. What are the cleaning requirements? How to clean this and that? So you can, if I give an example, ambulance hypochlorite spray, 0.1%. I think we got spray here. So we can spray. Likewise, how to do the cleaning also, 0.1% hypochlorite spray, reusable PP, how to clean, everything is mentioned in it's a small document, because I extracted what is the necessary things for you. If I give the whole document, I know you will not read anything. This is a guideline, so I will give one copy to each unit, so they can have own photocopies for the hospitals who has attended from other hospitals attended to workshop. I ask them to give one copy each. You can amend according to your needs and have a copy for you. That's what I have to tell. I think then I ask to infection control nurse to demonstrate how to wear PP and to how to remove PP. The most important thing, how to remove PP, because you want to remove it in a way, they have given a way, procedure to remove it, to not to contaminate yourself. If you contaminate yourself, no point of wearing PP. So you should know that. So they will demonstrate that.
We are going to demonstrate how to wear PP and how to remove PP. First, we are going to wear the gown. This is the way the gown. We can't like this knot because we have to overlap this gown for this proper way.
Turn back me. Turn back side. Turn back and forth. Back side.
have to overlap this down properly. And this is the shoe covers. We have to have the shoe covers. We don't have the gloves. So nowadays we wear the shoe covers. Then first gloves. We are ready to treating the suspected corona patient. We are going to remove the PPE. How to remove the PPE is the main important. So first we have to remove the first gloves. Front place. We can reuse it. Then head covers. You have to touch the inner side.
The outside is
contaminated.
Minimum 20 seconds. Hand washing or sterilizing.
Like influenza sample, you know about that. PTM media. This have two strips. The small one is nasopharyngeal. Other one is oropharyngeal. So with the PPE, you have go into the patient's room. And first you have to take nasopharyngeal sample. And we can tear it here. And then oropharyngeal and put it in the VTM media tube. That's the way. Then we have to, this VTM media, we have to put it in the polythene bag, absorbable bag. Polythene bag, we have to cover the gauze and put it in the polythene bag. Okay? Then we have container. We have to put it like this and with the ice cubes. First layer and second layer, you have to put ice cubes like this.
And body also can put absorbable material.
Mm-hmm. Then we have to closed and we have to label in this container and the cardboard box. We have to do two labels in this container and the outer part of the cardboard. We have to seal it like this. We can set no need PPE for sending this sample, because we have three packages now. So if the sample receiving person asking gloves, we can give, otherwise no need, because we are the other triple package system.